I would like to move on with the superintendent's report with transportation. Mr. Patchen, will you talk about the transportation analysis?
Yes, Dr. Wortham. The district is considering, again, the full outsourcing of our transportation services. We have a fleet with 18 vehicles, 16 buses and 2 vans. We have again performed an analysis, what does it mean for the district in case we decide to go and outsource this service to vendors, and that's a practice that you can see widespread on the New York State school districts. The reason for that is there is a financial aspect of that. We've done an analysis, and for the first year, the savings to the district will amount to $557,000. That will be the net for the first year. Again, the numbers, there are certain things on the numbers that we need to be aware. On this number, we have, last year when we did this exercise, we wanted to see the interest on leasing. That's a large area where the transportation depot is today. It's a large area, is inefficiently used. And we have thought and looked about what does it mean for the district to lease that area. We got one offer. There is a lot of interest because there are plenty of transportation companies that are on the other side of the river that would like to have a linchpin, a place on this side of the river and do operations. We got one offer which came from one of our vendors, Chestnut Ridge. Very interesting, and he said, he rated at $108,000 per year. Obviously, that's a very small offer, and we know that that is more to be gained from the lease of that area for transportation. I'm talking about the transportation depot again. And the way to do that and to find out what's the real value of a lease, which can provide for a stream of revenues for the district, is to hire the services of a full broker, assess it, see what the market is. Again, there is a concentration of transportation companies on the other side of the river. And the reason they are not in here, and the reason there is no competition in here, is simply they need space. That's why it helps the district in many aspects. Today, we operate with only 2 transportation vendors, student bus at Chestnut Ridge. We tried to increase the competition last year, and Brega was the third one, and unfortunately did not work out because they were found in breach of the rules by the FBI. Nothing to do with us, but that's bad luck. Again, the only way to control transportation costs is to increase the competition. To increase competition, as we have seen here, is a dearth of companies on this side of the river. They need space. And if this space can somewhat be used in a more efficient way, that is a gain for the district. In a nutshell, our analysis shows, again, a net gain of $557,000 for the first year. Again, we're talking now only for 18 buses, I'm sorry, 16 buses and 2 vans and 16 drivers that remain. All the drivers that are with, Mary can speak more about the drivers, but I do believe that 11 of them are vested in terms of health insurance, correct?
Yes.
Okay, 4 of them are not vested. What does it mean? It means that all 11 of them will carry their health insurance with them. And again, our vendors, and Mr. Fenton can probably correct me, have expressed interest on hiring immediately those drivers. So if you are working for the district, you carry your insurance, and then you go and work for a vendor of your choice. But that's where we are at this point.
Mr. Patch, you have any buses in our fleet that are less than 10 years old?
There is one bus less than 10 years old next year. Five will be 10-year, exactly 10-year-old, and 12 will be over 10-year-old.
So essentially, our entire fleet, with the exception of one bus, is going to be out of compliance.
12 of them will be out of compliance, five on their last year.
I want to be specific, compliance to the guidelines we've set for our other contractors.
That's correct. We have asked. We're asking every contractor to, our publicly stated request for proposal document clearly said that we want every contractor to have no vehicles older than 10 years in circulation. Someone might say, well, if you pass the registration, it works. Well, that's, you have to look deeper than that. You have to look at what it takes, what's the safety level, and what it takes to maintain a vehicle like that, and where we're going. Where are we going? Do we want to buy a bus? No. Where are we going? We have to make a decision and say, okay, this is the situation. Again, it is a it is an area that the district can very creatively use efficiently and provide a stream of necessary revenues that the district needs.
Mr. Finn?
There was one thing that Walter said is about the 10 years. They are allowed 10-year-old buses, but their fleet average has to be 7. So they can't have, you know, if they're running 200 buses, they can't have 110-year-old buses unless they've got 101-year-old buses. Their buses are equipped with GPS. Their buses are equipped with child checking. Their buses are equipped with radios. And their buses are equipped with crossing arms. The district buses only have crossing arms. So you're technically, you're at about a fleet age of 13 years right now.
Now, Mr. Patchy, stay there, Mr. Patchy. Mr. Patchy, if we were to want to get new buses, what the process
be? You will need first to get new buses, you will need voter approval. That needs, and the history is that the voters, my understanding is going back more than 10 years ago or around that time, they have not accepted that solution. So that is a complicates the entire budget. Because again, we will have to go to the voters and ask I don't have numbers on what it means to buy a new bus. We can certainly do that analysis, but we have to be prepared for going to voters and ask to accept that as a solution.
Mr. Gerhardt, have we been in touch with the unions and shared our intentions with them?
Not recently, no. I think Mary's giving me a look like I have. Mary, I think, has had conversations with the unions about this earlier this year, but maybe you can enlighten the board.
Yes, I have. When the analysis was done with regard to the age of the buses and our desire that the buses be no more than 10 years old, we realized that it's possible that the board might decide to lay off drivers, because if we don't have buses, we don't need the drivers. So the contract...
We need the drivers, we just don't have work for them.
Right, correct. So the bus drivers, it would be actually 16 remaining bus drivers and one employee with the title of cleaner and school bus driver. So it would be 17 employees. And they are part of the union, which is called the East Ramapo Maintenance, Transportation, Special Services, and Security Union. And I met with the union on January 12, 2018, to let them know that because of the age of the buses, it's possible that it could result in a layoff of drivers. And then according to the contract, we have to give them 90 days notice, of a possible layoff. And we also are required to meet with the union to listen to their concerns and to listen to their suggestions.
Have we done that?
Yes. On January 23rd, I met with the union and their NYSA representative and talked to them about the whole situation, what could happen, what would happen to the employees, and their basic suggestion was that a bond be put forth to purchase new buses. In recent history, that has been done twice. The last time was in 2010, and the proposal had failed 2-1. So, as far as the drivers go, both bus companies have said that they would hire the drivers. We also have looked at positions throughout the district that are currently vacant, and two of the current drivers have been recommended for other positions within the transportation department. If this does go forward, the board would have to take action at its meeting of March 27th, and the bus drivers would be laid off as of June 30th. Their health insurance would continue through August. And as Mr. Patchy said, most of them can vest their health insurance benefits. Anyone who would need to apply for unemployment would be eligible for unemployment as of July 1. We would help them with that. And we would also help them find jobs elsewhere within the district and also with the other bus companies, but if they're looking at other employment pursuits, we plan to meet with all of them should this happen. Each one individually we would meet with and go over what we can do for them.
Mr. Gurr, what type of action is required of the board?
On this issue, the board would need to take action. I'm assuming that, whether it's tonight or on the 27th, the board would have to act to make the change in transportation that's being discussed to access the buses, and then some of them, I would recommend that the clear explanation synthesized conversation from tonight as to why we're doing that be set forth in the resolution, and following that resolution to do a corresponding reduction in force as a result of the elimination of the buses. So I can envision, just thinking out loud, I can envision two different resolutions that would address the matters that are being talked about right now.
Walter, the
$557,000 first year.
That's because the operating costs of contracting out are lower than the operating costs of running it ourselves?
It's $557,000. The operating costs, if we outsource, are lower than our operating costs. The difference is roughly $365,000. How do we get to $557,000? Again, we are estimating the lease at $108,000. I don't have any other number. That's the only one that showed interest, but it's more anecdotal. I don't have scientific data to prove that, but definitely that is much more valuable if that is leased properly. So we're using $108,000, which you can add to $365,000, and then there is a sale of buses. I mean, we have sold of 32 buses, old buses. We expect to collect roughly $85,000 from that sale on the first year. And then again, it's the lease of the property that will carry on and provide the necessary and a very necessary and helpful stream of revenue. Like rental and permits are a stream, and they provide a stream and reliable. The same thing could be that area. If the voters have twice voted down for the introduction of new buses, therefore a more concrete objective solution needs to be found for the better of the district.
So it moved from being an expense item to a revenue item?
To?
A revenue item.
Or yes, it should be, yep.
Thank you, Mr. Finn. Dr. Worthy.
Mr. Wickham, would you like to weigh in on this?
Thank you. Just being here for the time I am here now, and seeing how this operation has unfolded and where we're going, talking with drivers, looking at the age of buses. I've been in the bus business my entire life. We need to either get new buses or get out of buses. It's simple. It's not about people, it's about safety. Our vehicles do pass DOT inspection. Our mechanics work diligently to have that happen, but they're at that point in time in their life expectancy of good, safe, solid, secure service. They're at the end. They're at that time. So I repeat, we either have to get buses or get out of them.
Mr. Wickham, I wanted to call on you before, and I'm just gonna just jump in and do this. When we talk about transportation, I made a note that I wanted you to consider looking into tiering the structure. For instance, in one district, they took 600 buses and they were able to stop using 600 buses and use 250 through a tiering process, which really enhanced the financial component. That's what I'm talking about, using efficiencies in the district to do what we have to do. That's how we got from a $6 million deficit now to a $9 million fund balance. So I would like you to entertain those types of efficiencies, and so that each bus can be maximized for the revenue. The board talked about the legal issues. Before the board can process the payment for legal issues, I have to sign off on it. It grips my heart to see the amount of money that we spend on legal issues when our students could so benefit from those funds. So I am asking you, we did not increase the amount of transportation, that line item, by that much, because in the short time that you have been here, you have worked together with Mr. Patchy and Mr. Afetibo to do great things. And so I am asking you to continue to research that you started, but we need greater work in order to do what we need to do for 35,000 students.
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. Mary, please continue to talk to us about what you have done. We have a timeline for transportation. Have we adhered to that timeline? And what is the next step?
Yes, according to their contract, We need to give them 90 days notice, the bus drivers, if we lay them off, and we must hold a meeting with them to discuss alternatives, suggestions from them. We have adhered to their contract.
According to the timeline, when did that happen?
So on January 12th, I met with them initially and told them because of the analysis of the ages of our buses and our requirement that buses not be more than 10 years old, and most of our buses were 10 years old or older, it was looking possible, it looked possible that there could be layoffs should the board decide to do that and just contract out all of our transportation. So we adhere to the contract by meeting with them, giving them their initial meeting on the 12th of January. And then I said to them, according to the contract, get a group of representatives together from your unit and bring your NYSET representative and we'll have a conversation and tell us what suggestions you have as far as doing, what else could we do other than lay off the drivers? What do you recommend? And that's when they said that that they recommended putting another bond forth to purchase new buses because it hadn't been done since 2010.
Pause right there. Mm-hmm. So, Mr. Saberlo, your thoughts about putting forth another bond?
So if you're gonna buy buses, a couple things. One, when you vote, it has to be separate propositions, so it would be independent. Two, it doesn't, it's not part of the tax cap, it's excluded. So you wouldn't get into a situation of if you raise taxes up to the tax levy cap and then you threw in some buses, you now need a super majority. Three, you'd probably want a bond because currently state aid now on buses is paid over the useful life of their bus, unlike in the past where you would get reimbursed the following year. So that basic facts on buying a bus.
Mr. Gerhardt, have we followed the course of sequence that was recommended as far as the process?
Quite candidly, I have not been that involved in that process, so I can't say yes or no, but it sounds like Mary's been very involved in the step-by-steps of the implementation of the contract. So I would defer to Mary on the implementation of the contract at this point in time.
Any questions, Mary?
I'm sorry, the union knew full well that this would be discussed at this current board meeting, and we expected possibly that some public individuals from the public or from the union may speak, but they have elected not to. And as I stated before, on March 27th, during that board meeting, should the board decide to lay off the bus drivers, it would occur at that board meeting. We would write a letter to each affected employee before that time, before that board meeting, to let them know that this is a possibility, that's the plan. And after that board meeting, we would write to them again. And then we would meet with each individual affected by this, the 16 drivers and the one cleaner and school bus driver, to talk to them about their options regarding employment and health insurance and unemployment if necessary. Their last day of employment would be June 30th. That would be within the 90-day requirement of notification, and their last day of health insurance would be August 31st, unless they have vested with us for their health insurance, which most of them have, and then they could continue the health insurance from that point on.
Okay. Does anyone else on cabinet have any other information they would like to share at this time? Any other questions from the board? Any other discussion?
I have a question, but it's going back to Walter. The 2% tax cap, is that 2% because the controller said that that's the rate for this year, or did the legislature change the law?
No, that's the controller's office. Okay. It just matched the maximum.
Okay.
For it's just the inflation is going up, and that's why. It's controller's office, everything is from there.
Okay.
Any more questions from the board?
Yes, one quick question. Dr. Arthur, we talked, I think, at the previous meeting about moving transportation to the central office. How does that play a role in all this timeline-wise?
So, with the movement of the relocation of the transportation department, we definitely want to do that, but I believe we're gonna have to move that out a few years once we cost it out, how much it would actually cost to relocate the Department of Transportation here. However, when we talk about being effective and being efficient, that does not mean that we change, we don't perfect the process. We have students who are being registered in transportation, students who are being registered in central registration, and the computers are not talking to each other. So therefore, we have determined to put before the board the process of identifying an individual to oversee the entire registration process. Now, we have, as you've heard me say in time past, that the registration process department has definitely been lifted, and I am extremely grateful to Melissa Barrow for the work that she has done thus far. Our goal at that time was to make sure that we knew every student, and that when students come in from other places, other countries, that they are appropriately assessed and they are placed accordingly. We have basically mastered that process. Now we have students coming in for kindergarten. We have the rollover. We need to make sure that we have the bus passes in place on time. So we have a new director who is absolutely stellar. So now, with having a person to oversee the central registration process and to no longer have individuals go to the transportation department for registration, then we believe that we will accomplish what we wanted to do without relocating the Department of Transportation.
Is the new phone system on track?
Is the new phone system, the question is?
Yes, in May, we're just waiting.
On schedule?
Yes, right now it's on schedule. And it's by my understanding, the system is talking to each other, the registration and where's the trends. Is there something that the court wants to share with me?
At this point in time, yes, they're in better communication with each other. So yes, we are.
Congratulations.
It's not but perfect. It's not where it needs
still better
to
than
be.
No, it's not where it's needed.
Not perfect.
No, it's not by any means.
No, it is not.
I mean, to be afraid. To be afraid is not. Yeah.
It absolutely is not.
Yeah.
And so we will post for that position, and the goal is to make it seamless. I'm told that when families go to the transportation department to register, lines are wrapped around. We want the transportation department to perfect their craft and to transport students. There's no need for them to have to register them. There are too many laws, guidelines. So this is just symptomatic of the systems that we have been putting in place in this district. And the outcome is increase in performance, increase in finances, so that it ultimately ends up in the classroom, and to have our customers, our parents, and our students treated in a capacity that they deserve. That's the goal. So, in coupled with that, you heard the presentation about online registration. We will fully have that operational so that parents can A, make appointments to register so that they don't have to take off time from work or secure babysitters. They come in and they know how long it takes to register, and then they have the capacity to do it online in multiple languages. I'm so glad you asked that.
Thank you, Dr. Wertham. Consent agenda items.
I wanted to give Mary Skolnick closing words on.
On transportation?
No.
On gas?
Yes, I'm sorry.
On transportation, yes. My closing words are
good night.
Definitely fiscally positive, and in order to age out the buses and contract out, it addresses safety. But of course, we all feel sad about the drivers, some of whom have been here for decades, and we are very sensitive to the needs of those employees, especially their financial needs, and we want to make sure that they are treated with kindness and compassion, and my department will do everything they can, should the board decide to go that route, and make sure that they can, that we help them as much as possible in securing new positions, and make sure that their health insurance is taken care of as well. So I want to assure the board that we take it very seriously, and my department is here to help them in any way that we can.
Thank you. That concludes the superintendent's report.
About time.
It is for the good of the board that we bring the information forward to you.
Thank you, Dr. Burton.
You're quite welcome.